إن الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله الله أكبر الله أكبر على من تكبر وتجبر الله أكبر على كل ظالم الله أكبر وهو رب العالمين يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري ويحدث عقدة من لساني ويفقه قولي أما بعد All thanks and praises due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek His help and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and the consequences of our evil actions. Whoever Allah guides will never be led astray, and whoever Allah leads astray will never find guidance. And I bear witness that there is only one God, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without any partners, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His last and His final messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, O you who have believed, fear Allah as you should be feared, and do not die except as Muslims, and in submission to Him. Amma ba'd. What are our goals in life? Where do we see ourselves 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now? We're constantly thinking towards the future, but have we ever thought to make goals for the akhirah, for our afterlife? The goal setting process is very interesting. Psychologists say, look at the big picture, make a big goal for yourself, break that down into many goals, and incorporate the daily actions into your life to accomplish those goals. And in the same way, obviously everybody here, our goal for the akhirah is Jannah. Not one person here will you ask, where do you want to be in the afterlife? And they'll tell you the hellfire, a'udhu billah. Of course it's Jannah. So what are those mini goals? What are those daily actions that we have to do to help ourselves get there? If I told you, do X, Y, and Z, and you'll become a millionaire, would you do it? I would leave the member right now. I'd go make that money right away, right? And the same exact way, if I told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said if you do 4 things and you perfect these 4 things, Jannah will be for you. So when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam left Mecca for the Hijrah, for the migration towards the Medina, the news of his arrival was very well anticipated. Imagine if a celebrity right now, imagine if LeBron James tweets, I'm on my way to American Muslim Center for Jummah Khutbah, what's going to happen? Everybody's going to be at the door waiting for him, looking at him. News are going to come. Everybody's going to be there. And when he walks in, all eyes and ears will be on LeBron James, for example. In the same exact way, that was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam entering Medina. Everybody wanted to see who is it that is coming. And when all eyes and ears were on him, that is when he made his first piece of advice to people in Medina. It's narrated in Sunan at-Tirmidhi that Abdullah ibn Salam radiallahu anhu said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya ayyuha an-nas, afshu as-salam wa utmi'u at-ta'am wa silu al-arham wa sallu bil-layli wa an-nasu niyam tadkhulu al-jannah bis-salam. O people, spread the salam, feed the hungry, be good to your family, pray at night when everyone is asleep, and if you do these 4 things, Jannah, you will enter Jannah with ease. 4 commandments, that's it. 4 simple things that summarize the whole essence of Islam. And so now I ask us this, how can we embody these things into our lives in order for us to attain that big goal of ours, which is Jannah? Afshu salam, spread the salam or peace. We already do that, right? Salam alaikum, alaikum salam. As we go about our whole lives doing that. But do we actually reflect on what that means? Sadly, we honestly belittle that in our community. It's something so important, so profound, but yet so simple. Assalamu alaikum is not just a greeting. It doesn't just mean hello. Assalamu alaikum is a dua in and of itself. Assalamu alaikum means, I want no harm nor anything to touch you. Assalamu alaikum means that I want no sickness and no hurt and only good and peace for you. Assalamu alaikum means I want Allah's salam for you. So how can we as a community say assalamu alaikum and then backbite each other and then badmouth each other and then rob each other or steal from each other or look down upon each other? It's contradictory. It doesn't make sense, right? And in that same way, the basis of peace in a land is for hearts to be pure. And the only way for hearts to be pure is to wish good for one another. And is that our state nowadays? If you really think about it, you see somebody get a brand new car. You see somebody become successful, and then what happens? Oh, in their face, mashallah, may Allah give you more. This is amazing. Second, that person walks away, what happens? Man, that guy cheats, that guy steals. He didn't deserve that. That's not really for him. I want that. Right or wrong? That's our state sometimes. And our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, none of us even have faith until we love for our brothers what we love for ourselves. And so if you look at this hadith and really analyze it, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say, Ya ayyuha alladhina aminu. He said, Ya ayyuha an-nas, O people, spread the salam. It isn't something just reserved for the Muslims. When Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam entered Medina, Medina was still new. It was only a small handful of Muslims in Medina. But he's telling everybody, spread the salam. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is telling us that make your character known. Spread that peace in the land. How many of us go to work for years? We live in the same house for 20 to 30 years. But do we know our neighbors? Do we actually go out of our way to spread salam to our coworkers? Do we actually do our best? If you were to move, would people say, oh man, a beacon of light just left the neighborhood? A beacon of light just left our workspace? Or is it something else? Do people really see a difference when we enter the room? And I hate to break it to you to make it pretty obvious. All of us here, we're a pretty diverse community. No matter how much you try to assimilate or change our names or do whatever it is, people may still look down upon us based on our skin color, based on our looks. MashaAllah, the sisters wear the hijab. And so let's be proud to be ambassadors of Islam and be of those who spread the salam to those around us in our communities and in our neighborhoods and our workplaces. So number one, afshu salam, spread the salam. Wa utmi'u ta'am, feed your food to the hungry. This in and of itself sounds pretty self-explanatory, right? Feed the hungry. But this symbolizes standing for social good, serving your community. It symbolizes that you stand with the oppressed and you're going to help the weakest of the weak, who are the people who have no food. In early Islam, one of the first commandments that came down, before Salah, before Zakat, before Ramadan, before doing Hajj, one of the first commandments was Surah Al-Insan, verse 8. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. And they give food in spite of love for it to the needy, to the orphan, and to the war captive. Think about that. The war captive is somebody who's considered a criminal in your community, somebody who's considered shunned and just put in jails. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, no, you still feed them. No matter the story, no matter the background, no matter what it is, you still go out of your way to feed these people and to give into your community. And a lot of times, if you think about that in our lives, we drive by so many homeless people. Just in Dearborn, on Fourth Road in Southfield, there's always the same homeless man that stands there. And what do we tell ourselves? Shaitan comes, this guy's a cheat, this guy's probably lying, this guy's a drug addict, this guy's an alcoholic. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, no, no matter the story, feed even the war captive, someone who's a criminal. So why not also feed the people in our community? And if you don't want to help them, that's fine. But also think about your Muslim brothers and sisters. We have people in Yemen, people in Syria, people in Lebanon, people, the Rohingya Muslims in Bangladesh. We have people in Africa and all around the world who are starving. And how easy is it for us to just go on our online, type in our credit card and donate whatever you want to donate, right? And if you can't even do that, if you're not in the financial position to do that, look at this metaphorically. We have people who are hungry for compassion, people who are hungry for friendship, people who are hungry for a shoulder to cry on when they have no one else to turn to. And so we could still be of those people. How much does that really take from us? A text message, a phone call, 5 to 10 minutes of just checking in on somebody? Anxiety and depression and suicide are at an all-time high in our country alone, and even in our communities. But are we doing anything to do our best to, like, again, be that beacon of light to see how other people are doing? So, وَأُطْمِعُوا الطَّعَامُ, feed the hungry, literally and metaphorically. وَسِلُوا الْأَرْحَامُ, be good to your family. Family is the building blocks of society. If our families are happy, then society is happy. If our family tears down, then society starts to break down. And what did the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say? The best among you are the ones who are who? Best to their wives. That's for the men. In another narration, the best among you are the ones who are best to their families. And so how many are the men and women in our community? Or even just us, look at yourself. Where we go out of our way every single day to do stuff for our boss, do stuff for our coworkers, do stuff for the community, but then we go back home and what happens? We become lazy. We don't serve our families. We come home, we become tyrants in the house. Or we go home and the ugliest of manners come out. How many of the men and women are there in our communities like that? And if you want to really see a real man, see somebody and look how a man treats his wife. If you want to see a real woman, see how that woman helps out and looks at and serves her family. A person cannot be considered a good person until his family considers him a good person first. No matter what people say, you will not be a good person unless your family sees you to be a good person. And that is the reality of a human being. How do we treat those that truly, truly depend on us? And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the concept of the family, it is stated in a Sahih in Bukhari that, O Rahim, O family, are you not happy that I will form bonds with whoever forms bonds and ties through you? And I will cut off the ties to the ones that cut ties from you? So the one who fulfills family obligations fulfills their obligations with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the one who abandons family obligations is the one who cuts off their ties and the obligations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reality of Surat al-Rahm is it isn't just treat those who treat you nicely back nicely. It is treat those nicely who may be unkind to you and your family. The ones who may treat you unfairly. The ones who may make sly remarks or may put you down. But you keep up with them and you deal with them because they are your family and you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wasilul arham. Be good to your family. And last but not least, wasallu billayli wa nasu niyam. Pray at night when everyone else is asleep. And if you guys look at this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put this last in the hadith. He put it as number 4. And it isn't to belittle anything. Don't get me wrong. The key element of our deen, of course, is salah. The obligations are the obligations. No ifs, ands, or buts about that. No questions asked. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is emphasizing the importance of our interactions with others. And we can't have a relationship with only Allah and not have relationships with those that are around us in our lives. And our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a private matter. That's why he says, pray at night when everyone else is asleep. Because that's a private matter. We're not supposed to be going around, we leave Jummah khutbah, alhamdulillah, I just finished Jummah, you post it on Snapchat. Or you leave one, or you do something at night, or you do something good, and you just put it all over YouTube, you put it all over social media. Our matters with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are private. We don't emphasize how much zakat we give. We don't emphasize how much we pray. That stuff is done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not to show off. And so if you look at it, the first one, spread the peace, that's interactions with other people. The second one, feed the hungry, interactions with other people. The third one, be good to your family, interactions with other people. And then the fourth one, fulfill your personal rituals and pray at night when no one, everyone else is asleep. That's a private matter between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's something for the individual. And why does Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say pray tahajjud? It's a symbolism for a person because no person is going to get up for tahajjud at night and give up his precious sleep if they're not praying in the day. No person is going to get up at night to pray tahajjud if they're not fulfilling the rituals and the obligations that are happening during the day. And again, too, in the last third of the night, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported to us that the last third of the night, which is the time closest to Fajr, Allah comes down to the first heaven and he asks, who is asking me so I may give to them? Who is calling upon me so I may answer them? Who is seeking my forgiveness so I may forgive them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, just ask and I'll give that to you. And tahajjud is mentioned again because it entails all of our religious obligations and is an aspect to perfecting our deen. So if we look at the hadith and we break it down, 75% of our religion is our interactions with other people and 25% is our interactions with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to bring happiness and peace to society. So at the end of the day, what's the point, right, of these big, beautiful messages? What's the point of these amazing pamphlets? What's the point of you only focusing on yourself and not spreading that to other people? Because before you can invite anybody to salah and to prayer and all these things, you have to first be able to invite your heart and the hearts of others to Islam. And a quick recap. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam laid this out clearly for us, saying, do these four things, spread the peace, spread the salam, feed the hungry, be good to your family, pray at night while others are asleep, and you will enter Jannah bis-salam. تَدْخُلُوا Jannah bis-salam. You'll enter Jannah with peace. And at the beginning, we agreed, right? If I were to tell you Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do four things, you would do it, right? We agreed. Well, these practices have now been shared, and it's up to us and our hearts to reflect, to choose whether we want to incorporate these things into our lives or not. And that choice is yours. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لِي وَلَكُمْ. Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, we are all actually at a great point in our lives. We are all lucky and should be grateful that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed us to be alive today and allowed us to come to the masjid and to hear different types of messages. There are millions of people in the graves right now wishing to come back and be in your position, wishing to come back to do one extra good deed, to do one extra salah, wishing to come back to do one extra thing in order to better themselves in the akhirah. And we, all of us, have that time now and that health today and that health right now in order to do these changes and incorporate these four things into our lives. So I ask, how many more Jummah khutbas do we have to attend in order to understand our true goals in life? How many more Jummah khutbas do we have to attend in order to incorporate the things that we hear? How many more Jummah khutbas do we have to attend in order to make a change in our lives? And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to incorporate what we hear, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to be of those to take advantage of our time now. Allahumma lakal hamdu bil Islam, wa lakal hamdu bil Iman, wa lakal hamdu bil Quran. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah wal adim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa la ali Muhammad, kama salli ala Ibrahim wa la ali Ibrahim, wa barik ala Muhammad wa la ali Muhammad, kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa la ali Ibrahim, fil alamin innaka hamidun majid. Ya Allah, I ask you to give us the ability to act upon whatever was said and what was heard today. Ya Allah, please forgive us for our sins. Ya Allah, please forgive us for our sins. Ya Allah, please forgive us for our sins. Ya Allah, please allow us to be of those who enter Jannah with salam. Ya Allah, I ask you to allow us to be of those who are able to spread the salam and spread the beauty of Islam and to be ambassadors of Islam in our communities. Ya Allah, I ask you to be of those who are protected from the punishment of the grave and the punishment of the afterlife and who are granted Jannah. Ya Allah, you know what we go through and you know what our daily struggles are, so I ask you to relieve us of these pains, relieve us of these things that we go through. Ya Allah, please accept our good deeds, please accept our good deeds, please accept our good deeds and forgive us for our sins. Please accept our du'ats and du'ats of those all around the world and those who are being oppressed. Ameen, 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 ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa akhiru da'wan, walhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.